So again, welcome to New Hampshire Trout in the Classroom. And again, this is an opportunity for you folks to learn how to do the logistics of the program, what it is, why we do it, how you do it, and some of the connections that we're asking your students to make back to their watershed. It's about the eggs, but it's also about a fish species of concern. It's all about keeping your watersheds healthy. And in some capacity, of course, raising the eggs is enough of a challenge, but we're also asking you to make that connection back to the watershed. And what is a watershed? Why is it important to keep it healthy? How might you do that as citizen scientists back in your own watershed? And how does that relate back to raising the trout eggs in the classroom in your own tank where you can see them up front and close? The Trout in the Classroom is part of the Aquatic Resources Education Program that we have here in New Hampshire. It is something that is federally funded by an ARE grant. The state match that is required that we meet is provided by you folks giving me your timesheets whenever you spend time at training, or teaching watershed concepts in the classroom, or going out in the field with your students, or going to pick up your eggs. Any of those types of activities are eligible for the match. And be aware that I will be pestering you mercilessly, as those that have worked with me know, to get your timesheets, because that match is extremely important to meet our federal grant. The Aquatic Resources Education Program is made up of the Watershed Education Program, of which I'm the coordinator. We call it WEP. So anytime I use the acronym WEP, that's what I'm talking about. And the Trout in the Classroom is part of that watershed program, but we also do warm water tank, we do stream study, we do water quality measurements, we do macro ID, we do ArcGIS, and any number of activities with you and your students out in the watershed, again, seeing and making sure that your watershed is healthy for fish and wildlife, and how do you help us do that? It's our mission to educate, it's our mission to protect our species. So when we do the WEP program, we're accomplishing both, because we're hopefully training conservation stewards of your students that will help us each and every day if they possibly can to keep the watershed healthy in whatever way that they can. The Watershed Ecology Institute is my summer training that I have every year that pretty much talks about all of the watershed education program components, or I also offer additional workshops throughout the year. And now that you're on my email list, I will be continuing to let you know about some of those training opportunities. If you ever don't want to be on that email list, let me know, and I'll be happy to take you off. But that does give you the opportunity to learn about some of our training opportunities. My partner in the ARE program is Kyle Glencross, who does the Let's Go Fishing program. So anybody that wants to learn how to fish can hook up with him, so to speak, and get their children out to learn how to fish in ice fishing, fly fishing, basic fishing, whatever your interest might be. So who sponsors Trout in the Classroom? This is a national program. And I have all kinds of web links embedded in the PowerPoint that I sent to you. I am not going to open those tonight. I'm going to offer you the opportunity to do that at your leisure. Otherwise, we'd be here until Christmas. But I've tried to embed all of the connections in this one PowerPoint that get you all the information that you know to do the program. So the National Trout in the Classroom is sponsored by National Trout Unlimited. Fish and Game doesn't own the program, National Trout Unlimited does, but we sponsor it here in New Hampshire. Other states do it differently, but here our hatcheries and fisheries division are in support of the program. Without the hatcheries, you wouldn't have the eggs. Without the fisheries division, you wouldn't get the permits. And they also are very good at answering fisheries questions if and when you have them. And the Watershed Education Program, we all have our own web pages. So click on those to find out more about those, again, at your leisure. And the New Hampshire Trout Unlimited, the chapters throughout the state are very valued partners. They do a lot to provide chillers. They, before COVID, they were doing a lot of presentations in the classroom. They are the cold water fisheries advocacy group for the country and here in New Hampshire as well. And they're a very good resource to reach out to for information, for resources. Some of them help with egg delivery, but their biggest gift is to provide chillers to borrow to the schools. So if you ever have a need of that, reach out. And I think we're pretty well on the way to make sure that all the schools get the chillers that they need to borrow this year. So our missions are dovetail with Trout Unlimited's mission. We are protecting the resources of the state at New Hampshire Fish and Game and educating the public about it. And Trout Unlimited's mission is to conserve and protect the North America's cold water fisheries and their watersheds. And the reason that we're species and habitat of concern is because some of those are getting stressed with such things as climate change and land use change and pollution and sedimentation. So this is a good opportunity to spread the word about how to keep your watershed healthy by preventing some of that sedimentation and pollution from happening. So basically, Trout in the Classroom and its environmental education program for students, and these are the many things that they do throughout. It is about raising the trout eggs and making sure that the tank water is healthy, but it's also to make sure that your stream is healthy where you're going to release your trout. And then overall, you grow to understand aquatic ecosystems and begin to understand the value of being stewards in those ecosystems, because each and every day humans can have some kind of impact on the aquatic resources. So we first want people to know the habitat characteristics of brook trout, what they look like, what their habitat is. So part of the presentation is just to go through that. For those of you who do not know much about brook trout, this is your opportunity to learn a bit. And we also have a lot of additional information in the Wildlife Action Plan and also on our web pages under the Fisheries Division. So looking at some of the physical characteristics, the fish that's on the upper part of the picture, of course, is the male. And these are male in their spawning colors with their bright red belly. And this is the time of year that they spawn. They are fall spawners. So they're out there probably starting now. And the New Hampton hatchery, which is the source of one of your, the Southern School's eggs, are beginning to spawn their brook trout now. So the time is getting there so that you're getting your hatchery eggs. And in the wild, they're starting to get ready to spawn as well, based on the temperature and habitat opportunities that they have throughout the state. You can see the nice coloration that they have. And the one thing that makes it pointed out that they're a brook trout and not another species of trout is the white fringe on the fins. If any of them kind of look alike, then you can tell by that white fringe on the fin that it's a brook trout as opposed to some of the others. The kype is the hooked jaw that's present in spawning males. And that's again, because it's a very competitive situation where the males are fighting to get into the female's nest or red. It's a very stressful time. They're all fighting to get to spread their genetic material. And it's a very long, can be a long time for some of these creatures. And they're not eating, they're not doing anything else except spawning. So some of them survive and some of them don't. These are the kinds of marks that you find on some of the older fish. You won't see these par marks probably on the fish that you have in your tank unless you choose to keep them longer, because the par marks develop a little bit later in their life cycle. But you can see from this diagram that the par marks are a way for them to camouflage and stay protected in the stream and the brook. They also have adipose fins, which cold water fish tend to have. And of course, all the other fins that a lot of the other fish have as well. So they need well oxygenated water, stream bed material for spawning. Typically pea size to ping pong size is their favorite spawning, but they also spawn in other type of habitat depending on what's available. They are found from high gradient mountain streams to slow moving meadow brooks, even though you think they might not be spawning there, but probably the ones, of course, with the higher gradient mountain streams might have the better habitat. They are a cold water fish. They need colder temperatures to survive. Anything above 68 degrees Fahrenheit is stressful to them. And that's why they're a species of concern, especially in areas where the streams are heating up, because they're losing their riparian vegetation or something else is happening. And that's why we have to be careful that when you choose your release site, then this kind of habitat that we're talking about is what you have for them so that you give them a good start. Food sources on all life stages of aquatic insects. Smaller trout will feed on zooplankton and smaller organisms. And other fish, of course, make up the diet. One of the messages for your students is big fish eat little fish. And even if you're stocking your little trout in an area where there's big trout there, don't expect those big trout to protect your fingerlings. You're going to have to release them in a site where they can get to cover and get protected, because there's a lot of competition and a lot of people like to eat little brook trout. So keep that in mind again as you choose your stream release habitat. So this, go ahead.
So if you're doing the macroinvertebrate sampling, is there a time when, I guess, what time in the fall do they typically hide? So when is what's roughly the month range in the fall when we could actually go out and sample and get some macros before they go into hiding?
The macroinvertebrates are pretty much throughout the stream all year long. They go through different life stages. And of course, the warmer the water, the faster everything develops. But you can find larval mayflies, dragonflies, stoneflies in the water in the middle of winter. I suggest, just from the standpoint that it's more convenient to do that, if you can get your students out in the fall, it doesn't matter the time. And generally September, October tends to be the seasons that most schools like to do their field work. And then if you can get out in the spring, April or May, to get the other end of the life cycle and get other organisms that you might've missed in the fall, then it's always good to do it twice if you can. But they will be there throughout the year, Rebecca. They develop and turn into terrestrial adults in their life cycle, whatever that is. Some develop into terrestrial adults pretty quickly. Some of your dragonflies will stay as larval forms for 2 years. So there really is not a set time. It's more just when it's convenient for you to get your school out there.
Okay, thank you.
So the wild fish, again, can be spawning anytime September through October into November. It depends on the temperature. And I have not gotten an update yet about the status of wild fish spawning, so I can't answer that question right now. And again, the hatchery fish, the New Hampton hatchery, has started spawning their fish now. And that's the source of the eggs for the southern schools. So the females dig the nest called reds. The eggs and the milt are deposited together. And that is where the eggs stay in the nest throughout the year until they hatch and develop and come up as fingerlings in the spring. So essentially what you're doing is you're mirroring the river in terms of your tank habitat. That's why when you have a tank, you need a chiller to keep the temperature in your tank similar to what you're going to find in the rivers and streams where the wild population is, because you're treating your hatchery fish as if they were in a wild environment. Of course, it's not the stream, but you're trying to keep the parameters as close as you can to what they would be facing if they were in the wild. The benefit that you're giving them is that they're not predated on and nobody's going to come along and eat them. So that's the good thing about having them in the tank. And that's why we're asking you to give them a good start. Put the eggs in your tank in January, keep them throughout the spring. And then when they hatch and start to swim up as fingerlings, then you're going to put them in your release site. So the life cycle again is the eggs. And after the eggs hatch, you end up with sac fry. And the sac fry is their food. That's their own lunchbox. They absorb the food in their yolk sac. And then eventually they will develop into the fingerling stage. And whether they're in the brook or in your tank, at some point when they've developed far enough and the temperature is appropriate in the water, then they will swim up looking for food. And that's when you need to think about releasing them in the brook. And that is timed based on their development, on their behavior, on absorbing the yolk sac, and whatever makes sense in terms of ease in getting your fingerlings out to the rivers and streams in your area. As I said, we have schools from Portsmouth to Plymouth to Pittsburgh and anything in between, and all kinds of rates in terms of snow melts and temperatures rising enough so that the trout can get out and find food. So as time goes on, you're probably going to have to keep checking in with your release river and try to have your tank at the same temperature as the river so the trout don't get shocked too much when you take them from the tank and release them in the brook. So any questions about the life cycle or what they look like or why we're doing this or why you have them in the tank so far? Any questions from anybody? Okay, great. So why we're concerned about brook trout, I encourage you to take a look at our New Hampshire Wildlife Action Plan. That's an action plan for wildlife that of species of concern and habitats of concern. The brook trout is in there, in addition to all kinds of other species of fish and mammals and birds. But basically the Wildlife Action Plan explains why the habitat is at risk and why the species is at risk. And we're asking you to help your students understand, what does it mean to be a species of concern? Why are they a concern? Why are they stressed? And what can we do about it as citizens and in their classroom and beyond? One of the major things that's happening, of course, is climate change. And when we have extreme storms and flooding that is caused by that, you may have storms that are less frequent, but they're much heavier and much more severe. They cause flooding. They bring in pollutants and sediments. And of course, that sediment can cover spawning areas for fish and also smother the macroinvertebrates, which tends to be their food source. Also, you can alter the stream, and a project that's going on throughout the state is to make sure that our stream crossings or our culverts or our bridges allow the brook trout to go from one side of the road to the other and can go through the culvert to get to their upstream side where they need to go for spawning, and also in the summer when they need to get to colder water to survive. So keep that in mind. And some of the schools actually do culvert surveys throughout their town just to understand what kind of a challenge that the fish might have. If they can't get through a culvert that's perched, they certainly can't get through a culvert that's blown out. And it's always a good idea to keep track of that, especially with these extreme storms that we're facing all the time. And the other major stress is rising stream temperature. And again, a temperature that is consistently above 68 degrees Fahrenheit is stressful to the fish. 65 degrees tends to stress the younger fish. And if cold water access is cut off and the vegetation is removed from riparian areas, then the trout do not have access to these colder streams and better habitat that they need to survive. And also they need more oxygen, and warmer water holds less oxygen. So that's also another reason that they're stressed as well. And this is some of the end result of some of our extreme storms. And this is the Coal River down in Alstead. And it totally rearranged the stream and the river. And this was back in 2006, and they are still repairing some of that damage today. And acid deposition in terms of pH fluctuations, we're doing a better job on that recently because of all the regulations of some of the coal facilities out west. But that's something that we have to keep an eye on because we're a granite state, a lot of our New Hampshire waters do not have buffering capacity. So any extreme change in pH can't be buffered and is not good for the trout. So Fish and Game is managing our wild brook trout population basically by keeping track of the wild populations. They're continuing to survey and figure out where these wild populations are. So one of the things that we need to do in terms of approving your release site, and the Fisheries Division does that, is to make sure that when you release your hatchery trout, you're not putting them on top of wild brook trout populations. And that's why we need to get you permitted. That's also why we need to have the Fisheries Division approve your release sites. And I just sent that over today to the Fisheries Division to get their approval. And if there's a problem with your site, then we'll get back to you and we'll offer you an alternative. The Eastern Brook Trout Joint Venture is something that you may want your students to look into. That is the regional group that where the different states are partnering together to make sure that you might be doing what you can to protect the brook trout here, but you also have to make sure that you're protecting it in the other states as well to give them a well-rounded, complete habitat throughout the country. And there's various survey techniques that we use to keep track. And some of the students that we've taken out have actually been taken out on brook trout surveys. So they can actually see what kind of populations there are of wild brook trout, where they are, how big they are, and whether or not there's good habitat and a good food source for them wherever we are. This is status and distribution of wild brook trout as of 2016. This is continuing to be updated, but this was what it was as of 2016. Red is where brook trout are not found, and the blue are where they are. And the red may just be that it's not good habitat or that site hasn't been surveyed yet. But as you can see, there's quite a few wild brook trout populations, and they're not all up north. And then there are various habitat improvements that your students certainly won't be able to do, but it's good for them to understand some of the habitat improvement that we're trying to do throughout the state to better the brook trout habitat. So any questions about how we manage the wild trout? I'm looking at your questions in the chat, and Emily, you would get help selecting a release site. We'll get back to the fisheries biologist and they will help you figure out where a good site is. And if you can help, I live there, I'm sorry. I hope that wasn't your house. but Emily, if you have a question and have a concern, then we'll have a conversation back and forth. If you have suggestions about where you might put a release site, I know a lot of schools down there release into the Cachico River, okay. Even if they don't live in Dover, the yeah. Cachico River is an accepted site if you have access to that. Carol, can you speak to releasing in the Cachico? Would you suggest that?
Yeah, I would, because I don't think it's, you know, a long drive. And I found out, Judy, that, and I think I read it on the Community Trail site, that the site behind Measured Progress, and that we use to do the off stream, that there is an agreement between Measured Progress and the city of Dover to allow people to access the community trail through that back parking lot. So interesting, because I didn't know that. So I would suggest that that be a site that people in this area shoot for, you know, because it's really easy for the kids. It's even if it's high water, the place where you put it in, it's low water because it's like an offshoot of the stream. So there's not a lot of danger. And it's easy for kids if they're going to go for a macroinvertebrate sample or do something like that. It's not really dangerous because it's not terribly deep. So that's what I would suggest.
Okay, thank you. And we have a track record of a lot of schools releasing there, so you will certainly get approval for that if you're interested in that choice. And it is a good site. Great fly fishing river, too. It's wonderful. Rebecca, how you tell whether or not it's your fish that they electrofish out, that's something that the fisheries biologist might be able to tell you. Otherwise, at that young age, sometimes when they're older, you can tell by the color. Which is a hatchery and which is a wild, but since yours were not raised in the hatchery, they might not have the same color as the other hatchery fish, because that depends on what you're feeding them and how long you're feeding them. So that's always a question, and I'm not even sure if some of the fisheries biologists would be able to tell you But it's always interesting to think about that and to wonder if you're survived. And I'm afraid we can't tag them or anything else. So it's really not possible to figure out whether or not your trout survive. But the better start you give them and the better habitat you give them, the better food, then the more likely they are to be successful. So sometimes the students want to know that that was their trout that they electrofished out, and it could very well be, but it might not be. So I'm afraid that's not much of an answer, but it's really hard to tell.
Yeah, so we talked where the wild populations are. So I didn't know if they were wild. So if we can't release them there anymore, because if there's already a population there or not. So.
Well, we're trying to keep any impact away from the wild population. And yes, once you put them in the brook, they swim and they move around, but we don't want you putting your hatchery trout where we know there's a well-established wild population. And that's something that the Fisheries Division has asked us to be aware of. In other words, you don't need to stack the deck by putting them right on top of the wild, although they probably spawn together and there's some commingling there, but we're trying to keep that to a minimum if we possibly can. Just because we want the wild population to be wild and genetically, I don't know if pure is the right word, but genetically free of hatchery fish as much as possible. So the wild population is pretty much managed the best way that we can to leave it alone, to keep it surveyed, to maintain the habitat for it, which gets us to why and how do we manage hatchery trout? And this is the source of your eggs. And the hatchery trout is to, the population is to supplement recreational fishing opportunities because it is a very popular sport to fish for trout. And we're trying to keep some of the pressure off of the wild population. So we have 6 hatcheries throughout the state that produce hatchery trout. They're stocked a lot of different places every year. And your hatchery that provides trout for the southern schools, there's a partnership between New Hampton and Powder Mill. New Hampton spawns them. And as I said, they're starting that now. And then they ship them to Powder Mill because Powder Mill has colder water. They're trying to slow the development down. So by the time you get them into your classroom, you can slow the development down more by keeping your tank water cold, because the warmer the water, the faster they develop. And if your water is too warm, then you'll be trying to release your trout in March or early April, and that's not good timing. And the Northern Schools hatchery is the Berlin fish hatchery. And they are very supportive. They are very excited about you folks doing this. It's good for them to make sure that the students understand what a hatchery is and what its purpose is. And we appreciate the fact that you are participating so that you can share that bit of information with the students. Plus, they are great in terms of answering questions. Please do not call them for food. I have the trout food if it's ready. And the hatcheries would be more than willing to give you food, but it's the wrong type of food for the fish that you have that are so young. So please contact me for food. So they take the eggs. The eggs are incubated in a tray. They hatch, they absorb their yolk sac, and then they're put into raceways to grow and develop longer. And part of the educational materials that we're currently developing for the elementary school level that Carol will be talking about is a video that describes that spawning process, because not everybody can visit the hatchery. But we're anxious that people know what that process is, and stay tuned. Pretty soon, hopefully, we'll have a hatchery video. We have one already for the older students and for other public information, but we're trying to develop one for elementary school level. So any questions about the hatchery fish and the process before we dive into how we actually do the program? I'm seeing a couple of, questions. I guess I've answered all the questions in the chat. So the Trout in the Classroom Teacher's Manual, and the link is right here for you to access it in the PowerPoint. This is the manual that again describes the logistics of the program. It is not meant to be a curriculum. This is more the logistics of how and why you do the program. And it's something that has been put together over the years by a lot of different people helping figure out what works best for teachers and how can we best get the information to them that they need in one place. So the first thing to do, of course, is to sign up. You've all done that. The second is to attend a workshop. You're doing that now. And then it gets to setting up your tank. So 30-gallon tank is a typical size. Anything bigger, you've got to maintain the water in it and make sure your chiller can keep it cold. And you need a chiller and insulation around your tank because you need to keep the water cold. 38 degrees Fahrenheit is a typical temperature that we keep it at. And you need to maintain that temperature until you start heating up your tank water to match whatever is going on in your release river later in the spring. Your water source needs to be free of chlorine. So whatever source you're using, make sure you allow the chlorine to dissipate and the chloramine to be used chemical to make sure that that's not present in the water. And you want to set up your chiller probably a week before the eggs arrive and set the range at 35 to 38. And again, we have community partners that can help you with a chiller loan. The substrate can be bare bottom, rocks, aquarium gravel, and the other tank equipment includes all the other stuff that you would typically have in a tank. The only thing that's maybe a little bit different is your turkey baster because you need that to remove the dead white eggs if any of them die through the process. This link is for a setup manual, and this is for a video that you can look at your leisure to get more information about how to set up your tank. So are there any questions? And this is what one tank that was set up looks like. Chiller, insulation, tank of course inside, and a little window for the students to take a look at what's going on. So does anyone have any questions about how to set up the tank?
I don't have a question, Judy, but I have a comment.
Go ahead.
The first couple of years I did this, I put lots of rocks on the bottom. They were cleaned and all that. And I didn't do that again because it's hard to see the ones that are dead to remove them. And when it comes to checking out, it's just hard to see them, the eggs. And when you go to release them, it can be very tricky to get all of them because they're very good at hiding. So yes. The first year I did it with the rocks, I came back and there were, I don't know, a good handful of little babies that I didn't catch. I thought I got them all, but they were hiding. So I would say go really easy on the rocks, or maybe put in one big rock, you know, because they do, it's just instinctive for them to hide, but one, and then, you know, yeah.
Good advice. Steve, do you have any advice about anything that you have learned in terms of setting up your tank, in terms of what to do and what not to do?
I go with no substrate. I find, for the same reasons that Carol just mentioned. And it makes it much easier when I'm cleaning the tank. And I do put, like Carol said, I'll put several big, good size rocks. And I find that they gather around, they try to hide, they use that for cover. I would say my biggest struggle, and it's still something I'm struggling with, and somebody mentioned it earlier, is the issue with filters. I've covered the bottom of the filter with that I'm not sure what it's called. It's like a white thick it's like a foam kind of, I don't know, it comes in rolls. And so I covered the bottom, like the intake of the filter, with that, and I still found that they were, you know, that some of the little fry were getting trapped against it on the backside of it where I couldn't see them, And I think that, I mean, I went through some really pretty like high mortality spikes. And I'm pretty sure that was the source of it. You know, they were getting trapped, they were dying, you know, and I didn't see all the ones that were stuck on there. So they were kind of breaking down, the dead trout were sort of breaking down and going through the filter and back into the tank. And it was really impacting the water quality levels. So I really feel like I have to figure something out, something different this year, to try to stop that from happening.
Anybody else have any advice about, because covering the filter intake, I've heard people use cheesecloth, I've heard people use pantyhose, I've heard people use some sort of netting, and nothing seems to work 100%. Somebody said putting your airstone next to your filter so it bubbles up and keeps them physically away from the filter, and or when you set up your big rock where they like to hide, set that rock away from the filter as well so they're not encouraged to go in there. I don't know if any of that would make a difference.
Well, the other thing, Judy, that I found that makes a difference is, and I don't know if you have control over this, but the length of the tube that goes from the filter housing down into the water, and then you get the part where the water sucked in, where it has the, you know, the openings, that's where you would put cheesecloth. But if that's shorter rather than all the way to the bottom, that makes a difference, because when they're little babies, they could get sucked in if it's long, but they're not swimming up yet.
Right. Right.
And if it's closer to the top, it'll still, you know, clean the water, but the babies aren't as likely to get sucked in. And then, you know, at some point, if they start swimming up, hopefully they're strong enough to avoid that, or, you know, if they get stuck, they can pull away.
Right.
But that's what I found helped.
That makes sense.
Tim, have you found anything with the tanks that you've set up that helps with that problem?
Actually, I have a little doohickey that's like a sponge that goes over the edge of the intake tube that keeps them out. It was given to me by someone at a hatchery in Massachusetts, so I don't know how regular it is, but I haven't had that issue.
So what kind of, it's just a sponge? Is it, you mean it's an aquarium sponge type thing?
It's a little circular doohickey that looks like a little koozie that slips over the edge, end of the intake that basically.
Oh.
Yeah.
The hatchery had that? You didn't buy that? I don't know if you can get that, buy that somewhere.
Well, the people at the Palmer Hatchery in Massachusetts gave it to me many years ago, so I've never actually had to go find one.
Oh, okay. That sounds like a good thing too, because it covers, it stays put, and it's a cushion, it sounds like too.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure that helps you, Heidi. Does that give you some ideas?
Yeah, I don't know. See, the first year they definitely went in the filter, and it was like a Finding Dory nightmare, right? Like, we're like one day, oh my goodness, look at all the fish that are swimming that are up. And then the next day we're like, where'd they all go? And we open up the filter and we're like draining them out. But that year of that COVID first hit, I would come into the classroom and they would just all be stuck to the part, the piece that goes down, and they didn't have the strength to get off. And so then I took like two clear plastic cups and turned one upside down and the other one like this, and taped them and put a hole in the top and the bottom so it could stick, you know, the piece that comes down. I wish I knew the scientific names for any of this,
right?
But the piece that came down, the cups were over that, thinking that would keep the fish out. And it worked a little bit, but what was happening too is I wasn't in my classroom every day. I was remote. So I'd come into the classroom a couple times a week and check on the fish. And I came in one day and they had all gotten into the little hole or from the bottom or whatever. And I mean, you knew the instant you walked into the room that there was a lot of not well trout.
What I can suggest, remember, there's the National Trout in the Classroom listserv that sends out questions to tanks and schools and coordinators all over the country. This tends to be a consistent situation, a consistent challenge. I like Carol's idea of shortening the tube. I think that might work. Give that a try. Send out a question to the national listserv. What I can also do is once I have everybody finally signed up here in New Hampshire, I can send out the question to the New Hampshire schools as well. And maybe through time and comparison about what other people are doing, maybe we can help some of that, because it tends to be an issue no matter where you are.
Yeah, perfect, thanks. Yeah, I was also thinking maybe I like the whole spongy type thing and thinking maybe if I had something thin enough that I could wrap around that whole little section as well as making it shorter, that might work.
Yep, the making it shorter, that's the first time I've heard that, but I think that might, because it's not close enough to suck them up in. And also if you put your habitat away from it, like put your rock where they might gather away, then that might help as well. Good.
And it was something that I tried because I kind of had the same issue, particularly when I was away on April vacation and I had my custodial staff sprinkle the trout food, but I think he put it all near the filter. So I came back and I had like 50 and like, where'd all the fish go? But so then I used the cheesecloth, and if you put it thick around the where it gets the water intake is, it seems to work, but then you don't get that water, it starts to trickle, the filter, yes, the water comes back in the tank. So you have, yeah. So I had to change the cheesecloth from around the intake because it gets all like gunky and nasty on the inside. So if you put it on thick and your filter starts to like turn to trickles, you might need to change your cheesecloth because all of like the gunk is getting caught in the cheesecloth.
Yeah, I think it's something that you have to maintain. You can't put something on and then let it sit probably all season. And that's the other thing that sometimes is an issue as well. So thank you folks for that. And again, we can send out a question to other schools in terms of how they might handle that situation as well.
Judy, I have a suggestion about the filters. Actually switched to the fluval filters. They're kind of look like a black box. They don't have the kind of waterfall effect. They're all in a box. And if you put those up near the surface more, kind of sideways in the tank with that bubbler underneath it, it really cuts down on how many go into the filter. So
excellent. Yeah. Excellent. Thank you, Kathleen. Thank you. Okay, so setting up your tank, that's one thing to certainly consider. And the next thing, of course, is getting your permit. So you folks are required to have a permit to have a live creature in your classroom. The permits are issued in January by the Fisheries Division, hopefully before you get your eggs. Although last year we had warmer water. So I know I sent you all into a panic because the eggs were ready mid-December. But whichever happens this year, rest assured you're okay because the Fisheries Division knows you're doing the program. You should have your permit before you get the eggs, but if that's not possible, we'll follow through and get the permit to you as quickly as possible and then post it close to your tank so that anyone coming into your classroom knows that you have a permit. This is kind of what it looks like. It lasts for the year, and that's why I ask you to fill out the registration form so we have all the information that you need in terms of who's doing it, where you are, and then where you're going to be releasing your fingerlings when they're ready. So then picking up your eggs, you need to go to the appropriate hatchery, of course, and closer to the time that the eggs are starting to eye up and get strong enough for being transported from the hatchery to your classroom, I will be in touch with you pretty much throughout the fall into the early year of next year to let you know when you can pick up your eggs. Now, again, typically they are ready mid to late January, but last year we had excessively warm water. I have no idea what's going to happen this year. So be ready to pivot, be ready for anything, but I will do the best I can to keep you posted as close to the time as you need to know to set up your tank ahead of time to receive your eggs. So you want to ask the hatchery what the water temperature is so that you match that in your tank as much as possible. And I'll try to keep you appraised of the water temperature as well. And you need to know the percent development of the eggs. In other words, how far have they developed it? Are the eggs 47.5% developed? Are they 46.3%? Are they 40%? And again, I have no way of knowing here, sitting here now, what that's going to be, but you need that starting point so that you can add your development that happens each day in your tank so you know how your eggs are developing and at what level. So take a clean jar and a cooler to keep it cool, travel to the hatchery, and make sure you're not shocking your eggs by putting them in too much of a temperature difference of your tank versus the hatchery water. Sitting here now, I don't know what our COVID protocols will be, but I will keep you appraised of that and ask that you follow whatever protocol the hatchery has set up, if indeed that's necessary. The southern schools will go to Powder Mill. The northern schools will get their eggs from Berlin. Then once you, go ahead.
Well, in the past, and I don't know, I have to be in touch with Mark about this, but Mark Seymour and John McKernan went up and picked up the eggs for us. And we met at a central location just so that the hatchery isn't inundated. And I will be in touch with Mark, but hopefully we'll do that again. And then folks down here, you would come to a central location and we'd give you your eggs. So we would have the jars, we would have all that stuff. So your job is just to get to where we are and pick them up and, you know, have your tank ready. So I don't know, I got to be in touch with Mark, but that makes it easier. It always made it easier for me, Judy. I don't know, you know.
Okay, but only certain schools have that opportunity. So all the ones that are in the Great Bay Trout Unlimited area have that opportunity. Other groups may also be able to pick up your eggs. We'll know a little bit more about that closer to the time of picking up the eggs. So once their eggs are in your tank, keep track of them every day. Remove the white eggs because they're dead and they'll spread a fungus if you don't get them out of there. You may want to monitor some of the water quality parameters. And of course, you don't want to introduce anything into the tank. You also want to make sure everybody knows about your tank so someone doesn't accidentally unplug your chiller. If you unplug your chiller over the course of a weekend, you can totally lose your brook trout eggs. So keep that in mind and make sure everybody knows that you've got a chiller that needs to stay plugged in so that your chiller maintains the correct temperature for your eggs. So tracking the egg development, they develop a certain percentage every day based on the temperature in your tank. The warmer the water, the faster the eggs develop. So you start with a percent development that the hatchery gives you, then you track your tank water temperature every day, figure out the percent development using the chart that I'm about to show you, and keep adding that cumulatively each day until your development reaches about 100%, which means it's about time for them to swim up. This is the chart that's in your teacher's manual. This is something that was developed by the previous division chief. This is a chart that gives you percent development based on the temperature. So 33.0 gets 0.288% development for that day. 33.1 is 2.294% development that day. This is what you're tracking based on your tank temperature. So every time you figure out daily what your tank temperature is, say it's 34.1, then you add this percent development to your cumulative total to keep track of what your development and what your eggs are developing each day. Don't move the decimal point. People want to say, you mean 34.9%? No, it's 0.349%. Leave the decimal point where it is and add this cumulatively each day as you track how your eggs develop. And the explanation of that is in the manual, if that was confusing as to how I just described it, so please take a look at that. Then when you have 100% development, the yolk sacs are absorbed and your fish are swimming up looking for food, then it's time to release your fish into the stream that you chose and that you're permitted to release. Then there's various things that you can do to clean up at the end of the year. As you put the chiller and your tank to bed, there's various things that you can do. We also ask that you complete an evaluation because the executive director and the fisheries division just likes to know where the eggs went, how many were released, and what kind of educational support did you give that shared the fish and game message about how to keep the watershed healthy. This is additional curriculum resources. Any of the information concerning the watershed program is on this page. And here are all kinds of other activity guides that have been developed nationally or developed in New Hampshire. There's an activity guide, there's a hatchery guide, there's a website, there's a video. And I sent you the ArcGIS map for this year in terms of what schools are doing the program where. So take advantage and take a look at some of these curriculum materials. If you want to collect data in your watershed, and this is part of the watershed program, there's all kinds of sampling manuals and data sheets. There's a manual and a video about how to do the stream protocol. We're not going to cover that today, but I give training sessions on that as well. If you're interested in the GIS aspect and posting your data, we can give you workshops on that. And I post all the data that you give me to share with the various schools. And this is the many ways that you can help keep your watershed healthy for your trout and support the fish and game mission, support the mission of the hatcheries, support a species of concern, and most importantly, keep the watershed healthy for them. And ultimately, if you're keeping it healthy for your fish, you're also keeping it healthy for yourself as well. So I'm looking at the chat to see if anybody has any additional questions. Does anyone have any additional questions based on what we just covered? That was a lot in a short period of time. Anything I left unsaid or confusing? I will continue to be in touch with you. You're not done with me yet. Throughout the fall and early winter, and especially when it gets closer to the time to pick up your eggs, I will be in touch with you. And keep you connected. If you ever have a question about anything, please be sure and contact me and I will be happy to help you. So any questions before I turn it over to Carol, who's just going to take a few minutes explaining some of the stuff that she's done to develop materials for the elementary school level. Any questions?
Judy, can you just clarify? So when I think about like additional supplies that we would need to purchase, those would be things like the filters that we talked about and the turkey baster and that kind of stuff.
Does someone that has a tank want to answer that? Because I don't want to forget anything to tell Emily to collect. So Steve, can you explain what you have for your supplies?
Well, let's see. I've got in addition to the filter, I have air stones with the little pumps. I have a couple air stones. I have a 50-gallon tank. Of course, you want to get, the test kits, the test for, your water quality testing for pH and ammonia and nitrites. That's important. I was able to find like a really extra long turkey baster, which is great. It's not really a turkey. I found it online. I found it like on Amazon, I think. And it was like anyway, it's really long and it's nice because you don't have to, it's long enough that I don't have to stick my hand down in the really cold water when I'm taking out some dead fish or something. So if you can find one, like a really extra long baster, that's worked out really well for me. I'm trying to think. I think that's, I mean, that's the most important things. Yeah, and I found like that foam, it's like a roll of, came in a roll. It's like a spongy foam that I would cut out pieces and put around the end of the intake for my filter. But I think I might try one of those other types of filters that I think somebody mentioned. But yeah, so that's pretty much all the stuff that I have.
Heidi, anything that we forgot to mention that you have?
As an extra, I bought one of the microscopes that hooks up to the projector in the classroom. And so when we're doing observations of the trout, I'll take a couple at whatever stage they're at and put it under that for the entire class to see, which is nice because then I don't feel like I'm pulling out some for every table. You know, I'm just pulling out one or two at a time and sticking it under there for them to draw and write observations about. So that's been really helpful. You can also use it as a video camera so you can tape them swimming around in there and doing their laps.
I like that. Go ahead, Rebecca.
I was saying I have one with my tank, but I don't know if other people do. I have like an egg basket. I don't know for the folks that have never done it before where you can actually find them, because what I do is I poured, at least last year, I poured half of my eggs in the bottom with a couple of the medium-sized rocks, and I put half in the egg basket, so that way it was a little bit easier, like if I wanted to take some of the fish, some of the eggs out to show students, or when they actually started to swim up, it was really easy to suck them up with the turkey baster, because I still kept maybe like 10 of them in the egg basket, so I could easily take them out and show the kids instead of trying to like stick with the turkey baster or the net within the tank trying to catch them once they were swimming up. So do you know where you can find the egg basket for the folks that have never done it before?
You can just get them right at any of the pet stores. That's a really great idea. We always have our eggs in a basket until once they hatch, we usually let them all out, but I like the idea of keeping a few right in there. Because we have ours under a cabinet that comes out. So the only way the kids can see it is when they take the window off that I made. And so it's really hard if they're hiding, it's hard for them to see it, especially with all the movement of the water. Cause I have a lot of air stones and, I have an aerator too that I tried 2 years ago that seemed to work really well. So I think that egg basket, for me, that's a must, because that way the kids can really see things well when you take the little window off.
The other thing that we have under all our tanks, we have 20-gallon tanks, and we have just get like a regular boot tray that has a plastic boot tray that has an edge, and the tank sits in that boot tray, and that keeps the condensation from going all over the place. So
the other thing that's helpful too is that when after we fill the tank, I will fill two more big buckets full of water and put the cover on them and have them sitting next to the tank on the floor. So then if we're doing a partial water change or we need water for any reason, there's already water that's been sitting out for longer than the 2 or 3 days.
Excellent. So does that help? Does that help? Okay. Carol, I don't want to give you short shrift, but it's 4 minutes until 5. Can you cover, I apologize. I talk too much. I'm sorry. Can you cover it, or do you want to work with me and set something up and send them something later that's a little bit more complete and doesn't rush you quite so much? Would that be a better idea?
You know what? I can just show them one website, and then because if they're in the planning stages, this website will be helpful, and then explain what we're trying to do. Does that sound okay?
That is perfect, and stay tuned. We'll be sending you out more. We just wanted to introduce it tonight, so go ahead, Carol. That would be perfect.
Okay. Can I hit share screen?
Try it. I think you can.
Yep. Share screen. Share sound. Share. You got it?
Got it. We got it.
Okay, good. So this is a website. It's at Trout Unlimited troutintheclassroom.org, and it has a lot of information for folks who are interested in pulling out activities. And as you can see, they have it across the curriculum, which I have found that Trout Unlimited not only goes from, you can have applications K to 12, but it also can go across the curriculum. And this resource is really good. What Judy and I are trying to do is, because if you're a teacher, I know how much time you have for this planning thing, and it's not much. So to have to read through every single activity on here, so for example, in one subject area, science, here's what you got. Okay, that's a lot. So what Judy and I are trying to do is develop a packet for different grade levels that we can give to you and say, here are activities that work with the align with the NGSS standards at this grade level. Here are the at this grade level. Because the fact is that from kindergarten through fourth grade, which is what I did with STEM, this program, this Trout in the Classroom topic, has something at every level for every one of those grades that aligns with the NGSS. Now, what we're trying to do is get that organized for you so that you have something on hand when you first start it, because it's an awful lot to, especially those first couple of years, to get the tank thing going and then that curriculum piece. It's like, you know, and the lessons that we will be developing are a combination of Google Slides and then, of course, the hands-on material. So here's a sample of one of the Google Slides that I made up. Now, the plan is to, and this is just my format, I have to figure out if I give you editing privileges, if it changes the original master slides. And I'm sorry, I can't answer that question right now. But by January, hopefully you will have all these bugs worked out. But this is the kind of thing I do. I like to use Jamboard, especially with third graders and older, because their typing skills are proficient. Are you familiar? Are folks familiar with Jamboard? Yeah, okay. Because the idea here is to get kids engaged. And in this first lesson, the idea is for them to begin to understand why they're doing this cool project. Because one of the things that I found when I was teaching science is that it's really great to do these cool activities when they're out of context. But you get to the end of the activity and you say to kids, so what have we learned? And they said, well, we've learned that, you know, and it kind of gets that larger point of the context of the activity, you know. So, you know, why raise brook trout? Oops, that there's Jamboard. Who, let me go back. There we go. Why raise brook trout? And then the other emphasis is scientists and engineering, science and engineering practices. Now, right now, Judy is working on, well, we are working on videos that are filmed at the hatchery that will work for the different grade levels. For example, the way the videos are being set up is that section one could be used for grade three because it talks about the body parts and the life cycle, but it could also be used in grade one because in grade one of the things that the kids have to look at is what are the parts of an animal or plant that help the critter survive. So that particular section could be used in first grade or in third grade, and it will satisfy those NGSS standards. So we're working on getting that organized, getting it up and running, so that by the time you're ready to start, Judy can say to you, here are the materials, you know, change them as you need to, develop them as you need to, and just to begin to organize a baseline, pool of resources at the younger levels. Because, you know, and of course, from fifth grade up. From five and six, there are still a lot of applications for the materials, that the videos that we're doing, but and then already there are lots of great stuff for high school and the upper middle school level. So we're just trying to get it organized and a little easier so that that piece is already done for you, because I know you have so many other things to get organized and plan for every day. Your reading groups, your math groups, you know, except for maybe content area people, middle school and up, but elementary teachers, we're planning for reading and writing and math and reading groups. And it's just science and social studies. It's a lot. So that's it.
No, that's perfect, oh, Carol. And like I said, yeah. Carol thinks she's retired, but she's just beginning. And we're not proud. We're probably going to be reaching out to some others of you too, to either pilot and or help with some of the concepts and activities and tools that we are missing that you really think you need and so forth and so on. This will be a collaborative project, but I'm delighted to have Carol helping us with it, because as you can see, she knows her stuff. So thank you, Carol. I hope you didn't feel rushed. I apologize for that.
Judy, do you want to talk about Megan and Stream Safari?
Not yet until we're a little further along. Not that we're trying to keep secrets, but we're still on the threshold of figuring out exactly what that means, Carol. So I think we'll wait on that and bring that in at a later date. Okay. In the meantime, thank you all for attending tonight. Again, stay in touch. Give me questions if you have any. We'll offer this recording. I've given you some of the PowerPoint and web link curriculum information that'll help you keep going step by step to set up your tank and get your eggs and so forth. I know it was a lot, so think about it and get back to me with any issues or questions. And again, we will be in touch throughout the fall. And thank you all for doing the program, and thank you all for being, will we meet again before egg pickup? Meet again in terms of what? Can you
just in terms of either a Zoom or other, just I'm just thinking about kind of the troubleshooting piece that, you know, obviously this is our first time through. There were just a lot of helpful tips and stuff. I'm just curious if we'll meet large group or if from here on it's kind of more individual communication.
But I hadn't even gotten that far. If you think another meeting would be helpful in terms of transitioning, I can always offer another Zoom in terms of making sure you've got your tank set up, troubleshooting if you're having issues setting up your tank in preparation to picking up your eggs. I'd be happy to time that a little bit closer to egg pickup time. If that would help, absolutely. And we can kind of offer it to everybody. I picked on you guys because you're new and I have to have you take the training so I can understand that everybody's on page one, but if people are interested in that, I'd be more than happy to do it. Good suggestion. Never gave it a thought. So that'd be good.
Judy, there's one other thing. Folks, as you're preparing your tanks, the picture that you saw had the thick, hard-sided insulation material. There's also a softer insulation material that I got, and I'm pretty sure I got it at Home Depot, but it'll wrap. So it's way more flexible. And if you wrap your tank in a layer of it and on the bottom and on the side, and then maybe get that thick stuff to make for a lid, that's in some ways easier.
Good
point. That's what I found.
And as we've pretty much figured out tonight, there is no one way to set up your tank. As long as you keep it covered, keep it cold, keep the eggs healthy and water quality good, then you'll be okay. I also sent you, remember, the ArcGIS map with all the participating schools. So I encourage you to take a look at that and reach out to people in your area if you have questions or want to do joint projects or want to arrange egg pickup together. That's kind of what the map is for, to give you an idea where everybody is and what everybody's up to. So thank you so much, and we'll be in touch, and talk to you later.
Thank you, Judy.